So welcome back. So in the last video, we looked at a couple of basic iterative methods like Jacobi iteration, Gauss-Seidel, successive overrelaxation, and we studied convergence of those. Now, as I already indicated in the introduction, those methods are quite old and they work for a large class of linear systems. So you don't need many special matrix properties for them to work. The more modern methods are a bit more fuzzy in that respect. So, for instance, they need symmetry or being positive definite. But it pays off because they can be much faster in convergence. So what we're going to consider in this presentation is just a bit of an outlook on that class of solvers. And they're all called Krylov methods or projection methods. So they are projection methods on spaces, and those spaces are called Krylov spaces. And I'm going to give a very abstract framework, and this is just to give you a bit of an outlook of what is there, and it's also a kind of preparation for the master's course called Scientific Computing, which is in Q1 of the Master of Industrial and Applied Mathematics, and that's all about these more modern projection methods. So let's go to the slides, and let me give you a little bit of an overview and kind of sketch how these methods work. So the situation is as before. We have a square non-singular matrix, a right-hand side, and we're trying to solve the system AX equals B, and we go to start with some initial guess X0. Now, when we were talking about Jacobi, Gauss-Seidel, and so on, basically what we did all the time is tell how you got from XK to XK plus 1. So here I'm going to start with X0, and I'm going to describe how you can find X1. So I'm going to describe one step of the solution method. X star is going to be the exact solution of the linear system. So what we aim for, what we would like to achieve, is that if we take many iteration steps, the XKs converge to X star. Now, the idea is that this matrix A here, if you want to use an iterative method, we assume that it's a sparse matrix, so many of its entries will be zeros, and it's going to be large, it's going to be a big matrix. So this system here, AX equals B, is going to be, say, a million by a million. Now, we don't want to invest that amount of work. We want to do a step. We want to get closer to X star, so we want to describe some work to get closer to X star, but by solving a much smaller linear system. In the end, I'm going to give you a method that's actually going to solve a system with M equals 1, so one linear equation. In general, we're going to say that we will solve a system of size M, and M is going to be much smaller than N. So typically, this guy here, N, is like a million, and this thing here, around 10 maybe. So the way we're going to achieve that is that we're going to say, well, I'm going to compute X1 as an update of X0, and this update S here comes from a much lower dimensional space. So X1, X0, and S, they're all vectors in Rn, so they're all vectors of length 1 million, say. But it's coming from a space with a lower dimension. So the search space, K, has dimension M, let's say 5 for my discussion. And I'm going to choose a basis in K, so only 5 vectors in that basis. And S is a linear combination of those basis vectors. So basically at this stage, my unknowns are the coefficients here in this sum, so the yi's. So now I have 5, M in general, but let's say 5, coefficients y1, y2, up to y5 to find. So I need some equations for them. And the way we're going to find them is, ideally, we would like the new residual, so the new residual is b minus ax1, ideally we would like it to be the zero vector, but that would incorporate solving the whole linear system. Now, the zero vector, as you know, is orthogonal to every vector in the space we're living in. So as a kind of milder criterion, we're not going to require the new residual to be orthogonal to every single vector in Rn, R1 million, but we're going to choose, again, another subspace, L, which has the same dimension as K, so dimension M, and we're going to require that the new residual is orthogonal to every vector in L. Now, since L is an M-dimensional space, that basically means that we can impose five conditions. So how can we do that? Well, we choose a new basis, a basis of W vectors for L, and we're going to require the new residual to be orthogonal to these five M5, W1 up to W5 basis vectors. So that gives us M constraints, M unknowns, M constraints, that's how we like it. We want to have the same number of equations constraints as we have unknowns. So here, K and L are still very general, and I'm going to fill that in a bit later on. So in a picture, I'm not sure if it's a very insightful picture, but still I'm going to present it. We have the space L here. Here is the old residual, so the residual of our initial guess X0. And now basically what we do is we go to update our guess. So we're going to update from X0 to X1 in such a way that the new residual is the red arrow, is orthogonal, makes a 90 degree angle to L, which I drew as a plane here. So let's see if you write that out, then the new residual, that's B minus AX1. For X1, I plug in X1 is X0 plus S. And then if you rewrite that a little bit, you see that apparently R1 is the old residual minus AS. Okay. Now, in this course, we've always been looking to write equations in matrix vector formulation. So let's try to do that here too. So we have our search space K. We have basis vectors V1 up to Vm. And now I'm building a matrix capital V of those basis vectors. And then S is a linear combination of the Vs, can be written as S is V times Y with Y a vector in R5, the five missing coefficients. Similarly, the condition we have, the orthogonality condition, requiring that the new residual is orthogonal to the space L, can also be written in terms of matrices. So, like I did for K, I'm also going to say that I'm going to build a matrix capital W with the W vectors, so W basis vectors. And the orthogonality conditions, well, being orthogonal to all the basis vectors is written here. The dot product can be written as this, and then I'm going to collect all these M equations together by writing that the big matrix W transpose times the new residual equals zero. And then if I plug in what we had from the previous slide, that the new residual is the old one minus AS, we see that we have an expression for the unknown vector of coefficients Y. So what we find is that Y is the solution, well, of this linear system, and I wrote that with an inverse here. So the unknown five coefficients Y1 up to Y5 follow from this equation, and this matrix here, W transpose AV, that's a 5x5 matrix, so a much smaller matrix than our original linear system. So the next approximation, x1 is x0 plus s, s is v times y. I've now found y and I plugged that in, and we have the expression here for the next approximation of the solution of a linear system, and we can repeat this step. Now, we basically have all the ingredients now to build a prototype projection method. So there is a whole bunch of methods that follow this prototype. As soon as we make choices for k, l, and basis vectors, we have a projection method, an iterative method. So how does it work? We start with an initial guess and compute a residual. That's little r here. We select subspaces. Then we choose bases in them. Next, we build these matrices, big V, big W. We compute the coefficients of the update. So that's our y vector here, a vector of length 5, length m in general. We compute the new approximation. If it's sufficiently accurate, we're happy, we stop, and otherwise we go back to step 1 and we increase our counter. So the idea why this is advantageous, why this is cheaper, why this is less work per iteration step, maybe we need many iterations, I didn't say anything about that yet, but every iteration step is quite cheap because the system that we have to solve here, so this is the only place where we have to solve a linear system, is much smaller. It's 5 by 5 rather than 1 million by 1 million. So to indicate that a little bit clearer, our original matrix is 1 million by 1 million. These V and W have 5 columns, and every column has length 1 million. So they're very thin, long matrices, like you see here for V. And this is W transpose, so it's the transpose. It only has 5 rows and 1 million columns now. And if you multiply this whole bunch together, then you know from the rules of matrix multiplication that this is going to give you an M times M, a 5 times 5 linear system. Couple of remarks. First, this is just naming. If K equals L, you can do that. You can choose them to be the same spaces. Then this is called an orthogonal projection and otherwise an oblique projection. Common choices, so many of these projection methods have the scheme that L equals K or A times K. So this means that if you take a basis in K, you apply your matrix to every basis vector, then you find a new basis because our matrix is non-singular, that spans a space, and that space is L. You want the system to be non-singular. And then a little bit about accuracy. So when do we stop? What you would like is that the solution of your linear system X that we're looking for minus our current approximation is less or equal some error. But of course, we don't have this thing. So in practice, what we do is either look at the residual, because we can compute that, or we can look at the update. So we look how the current approximation changes in every iteration step. If it kind of stagnates, if nothing's happening there anymore, that might also be a stopping criterion. Now, to wrap this up, the discussion, let's look at a little example where I make special choices for K and L, and I'm going to choose M equal to 1, so one-dimensional spaces. So here's the general framework, I didn't change anything there. Now I'm going to make some choices. So, well, K is one-dimensional, so if M equals 1, we're going to choose a one-dimensional space. There is not much to choose from, so we choose the current residual as the basis vector for this one-dimensional space. K is going to be all linear combinations of the initial residual. Then our update, S, is going to be some constant times this basis vector. So there is one unknown. One Y used to be a vector. It only has one component now, so we denote it with a normal Y because it's a number. And we choose now L equals K. So L, the orthogonality space, is also the span of this one basis vector, little r. And then the condition is that the new residual should be orthogonal to the old residual. Now, if you write that out, if you have this constraint and you just plug in all the numbers that we had, then in the number of steps, you find a formula for Y. So we're basically solving here a one linear equation, a linear system of size 1 by 1, because M equals 1. So one linear equation. And this is what is called the steepest descent method. So our update, we have an initial guess X0. X1, the next iteration, is X0 plus S, and that is Y times the old residual, and Y is this number that you can compute. So apparently this algorithm, called steepest descent, solves a linear system provided you take sufficiently many iterations. You can probably imagine if you want to solve a 1 million by 1 million linear system that we're going to be needing quite a few iterations to get there. So L equals K, which means that this is an orthogonal projection method. And you can show, I'm not going to do that here, this converges if your matrix is symmetric positive definite. And it even goes monotonically. So what that means is if you look at the energy norm or the A norm, so that's this is a vector norm, that the residual goes down in every iteration step. So that's a very nice property. It means that every step that you take, you get closer to the solution of your linear system. That doesn't always hold true. So you have iterative methods that you do like 1,000 iterations and the residual goes down, 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 and then it can peak again. So not in this course, but if you would study scientific computing in the master, you will learn all about that. Finally, Krylov subspace methods. So these are the most important iterative solution techniques that you find. Commercial solvers have them built in, and you will see their names at many places. If you're going to solve large, sparse linear systems, typically the one that you get from discretizing boundary value problems, partial differential equations. So what they are, those spaces, is the space that is being spanned by these basis vectors. So you start with the initial residual, and then you apply your matrix A there. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on that, but we have been talking about the power method to find eigenvectors and eigenvalues. And you have seen that if you do the normal power method without shift, no inverse iteration, the normal power method, that it will always go, if you would compute this sequence of vectors, they will go to the eigenvector belonging to the dominant eigenvalue. So apparently if you're going to compute this space here or these basis vectors, you have to do something special there. So that's why we have a complete course on scientific computing, because this is not a good way to do that. So standard choices for L is then, well, either the same, so L equals K or A times K, or maybe something with the transpose matrices, but let's not go into that here. Then basically the way you're building a basis for this Krylov space, so this is called the Krylov space, that also it was invented by the mathematician called Krylov, and that's also why they denoted with K. And there are three main categories. So there was those based on Arnoldi's method, and that's just a way of finding a basis in a good way for this space here. And GMRES is the most famous of those methods. So GMRES is an iterative method. It's commonly used. It uses up a lot of memory in a computer though, and more clever versions have been found. If you have symmetric matrices, you can do a cheaper version, which is called Lanczos, and then you get to the conjugate gradient method, and you may have heard of that. That's one of the most famous iterative solution techniques. And then CG is like the common choice if you have a nice matrix, symmetric, positive, definite. If you have a non-symmetric matrix, you still would like to have something like CG, and these things are all kind of generalizations to non-symmetric systems, like biconjugate gradient, and that has a very spiky convergence behavior, so the residual goes up, down, and so on, and this is a stabilized version, and BiCG step has been proposed by a very famous Dutch numerical mathematician, Henk van der Voorst. So, to wrap up our discussion about iterative methods, what we have seen is that you can use iterative solution methods for very large sparse linear systems. The main reason being that if you would do LU factorization, you would get fill-in. So even if your original matrix has many zeros, the L and the U may not have. So there it becomes cheaper. You can classify them into the fixed point methods, that's Jacobi, Gauss, Seidel, Azawar, and the projection methods that I've just been talking about. Jacobi, Gauss, Seidel, SOR, you can find them by using a matrix splitting. So we wrote our matrix in terms of its diagonal, it's the part below and the part above the main diagonal. We have seen for those types of matrices how you can study convergence, and that all depended on the spectral radius, the biggest eigenvalue of the iteration matrix, G. And we've seen that for a couple of matrices, like, for instance, if they're irreducibly diagonally dominant, that you get convergence. And finally, and that was this video, we have seen how you can formulate a general framework for projection methods. and a bit of an outline how these methods work. So this concludes the week 6 material and iterative methods. And in week 7, there is going to be a couple of fun applications. One video is already online, the other one I'll put there quickly. And they have to do with face recognition and with Chladni patterns, which are basically the eigenvalues, eigenmodes of a thin plate vibrating. And it's a very old technique to make sound visible. So this concludes this video, and I hope to see you in the next video. Thanks for your attention.